And earth, and on the seventh day he rested, and he was refreshed. Now, the commandments of God, they're all promises, aren't they? They're promises. It isn't a list of do's and don'ts. If you see it as a list of do's and don'ts, then you've totally missed the boat, in my opinion. Okay? Because a dead man can keep 8 of the commandments. But there's 2 commandments that require you to do something. And the fourth is, requires you to keep, protect, cherish the Sabbath day in whom you come to worship God. And if that's work for you, then I think you missed the boat. The fifth commandment, what's it say?
Honor father.
Honor thy mother and father. Okay? If honoring your mother and father is work, you guys really missed the boat. You totally missed it. So none of the commandments are work, but promises. Correct? Alright, now I want you to turn to Exodus 33. And I'm going to start reading in 11. And the Lord spake unto Moses face to face, as a man speaketh unto his friend. And he turned again into the camp. But his servant Joshua, the son of Nun, a young man, departed not out of the tabernacle. And Moses said unto the Lord, See, thou sayest unto me, Bring up this people, and thou hast not let me know whom thou wilt send with me. Yet thou hast said, I know thee by name, and thou hast also found grace in my sight. Now therefore I pray thee, if I have found grace in thy sight, show me now thy way, that I may know thee. That I may find grace in thy sight, and consider that this nation is thy people. And he said, My presence shall go with thee, and I will give thee rest. And he said unto him, If thy presence go not with me, carry us not up hence. For wherein shall it be known here that I and thy people have found grace in thy sight? Is it not in that thou goest with us? So shall we be separated, I and thy people, from all the people that are upon the face of the earth. And the Lord said unto Moses, I will do this thing also that thou hast spoken, for that thou hast found grace in my sight, and I know thee by name. And he said, I beseech thee, show me thy glory. And he said, I will make all my goodness pass before thee, and I will proclaim the name of the Lord before thee, and will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and will show mercy on whom I will show mercy. Praise be to God. And he said, Thou canst not see my face, for there shall no man see me and live. Do you hear anything in there? Does there sound like an apparent contradiction in Scripture there? Let's go back up. Hold your finger on 20 and go back up to verse 11. What does it say? And the Lord spake unto Moses face to face. Okay? And in verse 20 it says what? And he said, Thou cannot see my face, for there shall no man see me and live? Ooh. Sounds like an apparent contradiction, doesn't it? But there must be a way that God can speak face to face and we not see his face. Pardon me? A fog? Well, I don't know. I have to take this by faith. Okay? I really don't know. I don't have the answer here. But I know there's no contradiction in the Scriptures. I only bring that to your attention to make you realize how awesomely great our God is. That he can speak to you face to face. And you not die. But if he is to pull back the veil, so to speak, the Bible says right there that no man can live and see his face. There's one more thing I wanted to show you guys here. I think it's 34:6. And the Lord passed by before him and proclaimed the Lord great, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abundant in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin and that will by no means clear the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children and upon the children's children unto the third and the fourth generation. That's heavy duty. There is something here that I want to, one more thing I want to show you, and I can't find it now. Let's turn to Leviticus 23 and 3. Six days shall work be done, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of rest. A holy convocation. What's a holy convocation?
Gathering, assembly.
Absolutely. You shall do no work therein. It is the Sabbath of the Lord in all your dwellings. I can't seem to find it, but we're running out of time here, and I got more stuff I want to get to, but I'm not going to get there, so I'll find it for you guys later. They come to Vespers. There's a text in there that talks, well, you know what, it's probably around Exodus. So I'm not sure. Okay, here it is. Thank you, Lord. Exodus 32 and 15. Exodus 32 and 15. Just give me a holler when y'all get there.
Amen.
Amen.
All right. And Moses turned and went down from the mountain, and the two tables of the testimony were in his hand, and the tables were written on both their sides. On one side and on the other side were they written. Did you know that? A lot of people don't know that. That the Ten Commandments was written on both sides of the stone. And I want to show you something here. I can't remember the king's name, but they found this. They excavated this not too long ago, but a while back. In that area, there was a king, and I can't even remember his name. They dug this up, and on clay tablets, he had his law written, just to show that the Bible was true again, that he also, this king, and I can't remember his name, like I said, had his law written on both sides of the tablet, okay? But he would take his signet and push it right in the middle of his law so that you would know that that was authentic, that was the real law. See, so you could see the law, but then you couldn't read out the middle so much because his insignia was put there. His name, his title, you know, his territory, like the present United States, you know, blah, blah, blah. And it smudged out part of the law. That's why it was written on both sides. So you could flip it over and still read the law. Now, the Ten Commandments, what is in the middle of the Ten Commandments? The fourth commandments. And what is the fourth commandment if it's not the sign and the seal of Almighty God? See, this is so beautiful. The Lord is just so gracious to us. The time is coming, brothers and sisters, when this religion of sight is going to be everywhere you see. And even God is going to allow the devil to show that he's brought fire down from heaven. Not that I even know that it would really be fire from heaven, but people are going to physically see fire come down from heaven. Why is God going to allow that? You got to ask yourself that question. I might give it to you at Vespers. Other than that, I'm just trying to get people to come to Vespers. It's a wonderful time to get together. And you know, Sabbath school is a wonderful time. So many of you miss that. We're light today. There's like not many people here. I don't know where everybody went. I know some people went up to camp. I can't think of a better place to be on the Sabbath than in the Lord's house. You know, I don't care what goes on. The Sabbath, even if it was snowing outside, the Sabbath is still the best day. And I hate snow. Believe me, I don't live here for no reason at all. I hate snow. I hope there's no snow in heaven. I don't believe in the world. Yeah, you can go to a snowboard. That's right. You know, and you can travel at the speed of thought, okay? So you can be there in like no time. Well, it should be a problem. Anyways, I'm going to close there. And let us not forget that, you know, we can never put the horse before the cart. And what we're talking about here in the seventh-day Sabbath, in this man-made Sabbath, is it's more than just a day. It's two types of salvation. Do you understand that? This is very deep. It's two types of salvation. Am I trusting God for my salvation, or am I going to go my own way and do my own thing? You see? It's really that simple. We just need to listen to the Word of God. He didn't make it difficult. He promises that even a little child can understand this. But there's so much in this wonderful, glorious book that it can just blow the mind of the deepest theological thinker. You know, we are living in a wonderful time. Didn't they just the other day discover Einstein's theory of, what is it?
Relativity.
Yeah. They were just able to prove it. 100 years ago, he said it to people that, you know, the Lord is so far ahead, and he understands everything, and he loves us so much, and he wants to protect us. But if we won't come and sit on his knee, we won't learn and eat from his hand, how can he help us? How can he do? He loves us all so much. I pray that you just seek his face. I pray that you lay down all the junk and just love him. Trust him. Believe his word, because he cannot lie. It's impossible for God to lie. Everything he says is nothing but truth. Okay? And I've told you before that your sins don't belong to you. They belong to Jesus. He purchased them at the cross. They're not yours. They don't belong to you. So give Jesus what belongs to him and take what he has for you. You're only giving away what you can't keep anyway. So that you can gain what you can never lose. Brothers and sisters, look to Jesus. He is always and forever will be our answer through eternity. Our closing song is 5:34. all, I want you to know before I close here that we're going to have a fellowship meal back there. You're all welcome to stay. Plenty of good food. This is vegan Sabbath, isn't it? Yeah. Vegan food back there. Fantastic. Dear Heavenly Father, we want to thank you so much for the beautiful Sabbath day that you've created. I pray that we just take you at your word, Lord, that we stop trying to do these twistings and turnings and try to make things say what we want them to say, but that we would just take your Lord, take your word, Lord, as a little child understands and takes his word from his mother and his father, and he goes on and learns and grows. I pray that you make us like little children, that our minds would be like sponges, that we would lay down all the preconceived notions that we have about you and what you're doing and your people, and that we would take a new and a fresh look so that you can move us and get us out of this slowness, this stagnation. Let us feel real life come through our veins, Lord, because we trust you, because we believe you, because we follow you, and because we are filled with your Holy Spirit. We want to be baptized with you, Lord. Please, I pray that this little church would just be on fire for you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen.